There's a river that behind our house called Calcasieu River. The Indian name for that is Screaming Eagle. Calcasieu's Indian name means Screaming Eagle. Well, on this river's every little hole on this river, we growing up, me and my brother Juan, we'd float the river and we could tell you every little hole's name, every little bend. We had a name for it. And one of those little bends in the river is called the Rudy Bend. Well, we named Rudy Bend. You couldn't hardly get a hook down that in that water there without getting a hook and a root. So we named it Rudy Bend. But in the middle of Rudy Bend's a big stump. In the middle of that stump was a strong little tree branch growing out of it. And it was known for a spotted cat around that stump. And I had a good bait on it one afternoon, and a good little perch bait. And I went there, and had a guy with me run my hooks that night. And, boy, that whole limb was down that water just doing that. So, boy, it must be a fantastic fish on that hook. So instead of grabbing the line, he grabbed the branch. I knew that was wrong for him to do that. And it broke, slipped away. And we lost that, whatever it was. It had to be a good one. And, of course, the Word of God tells us, and I want you to turn with me to Hebrews, sometimes we let things slip. Sometimes we let things go. Now, I never did get to see what size fish that was, but I believe it was a good one. And, of course, I'll never know. But the Scripture tells us in the book of Hebrews, chapter 2, that we have a danger or we can lose some things and let them slip. I believe with all my heart that folks let things slip and they let them go. And the writer of Hebrews says in chapter 2, verse 1, it tells us, therefore, we ought to give the more earnest heed to the things which we've heard, lest at any time we should let them slip. Hebrews chapter 2, verse 1. I want you to look real close at that scripture, because I believe with all my heart that folks have let a lot of things slip through the years. And they've missed their opportunity, because that really means is you it's like it's something that can be poured out. The Greek for that means you can be poured out and lose it. You can lose it. And through the years, folks have lost the message and lost the truth. And the seriousness of losing the truth of our salvation is just paramount today. Religion today, modern religion, has for the most part missed it. They missed the Lord. The Israelites 2,000 years ago, they missed Christ. They knew Him. They received the ordinances. They received the signs. And Acts chapter 7 and 53 said that their prophets, they slew the prophets that spoke of Him. What does that mean? They killed the prophets that were speaking of their salvation. Acts 7:53, they slew him, hang him on a tree. And they lost it. They let it go. They missed it. I'm almost to the point today, and I believe in my spirit that folks have missed it today in trying to compromise the message and being caught up with the things of the world. They've missed Christ and let it slip. Let it slip away. The deadness in the hour and the coolness in the hour and the lukewarmness in the hour, they're not aware of judgment to come. Psalm 68, verse 17 says, the chariots of the Lord are 20,000 and thousands of angels which were present at Sinai when Moses received the law. It was ordained by angels of God, thousands of angels, 20,000 chariots of angels and thousands of angels ordained the Ten Commandments and ordained the law. It was ordained by God, witnessed by thousands of God's angels. The writer of Hebrews tells us in verse 2, he again references to the angels that witnessed God. Look at it. For if the word spoken by angels, look at that scripture, by angels was steadfast. Look real close at this. Steadfast. And every transgression and disobedience received a just recompense of reward. When the law was added because of transgression, because the Israelites had sinned, God has the law because of sin. He has the law, and he said, this is why this is sin. And the angels witnessed. And every time those Israelites broke the law, what happened? They died. Every time a law was broken, they were stoned. They were murdered. They died. Every act of disobedience, they suffered judgment. Do y'all believe God's dead today? Do you believe he's still alive?
Amen.
Do you believe that he's aware of everything that goes on the earth? I think for the most part, folks have let it slip. And they've appeased and tried to compromise what the Bible teaches, and they've missed it. Verse 3 tells us real clear, how shall we? Now I want you to look at that. How shall we escape if we neglect so great a salvation, which at first began to be spoken by the Lord and then was confirmed unto us by them that heard him? Who's he talking about? Him. The Lord Jesus. God also bearing them witnesses both with signs and wonders and with divers miracles, verse 4, and the gifts of the Holy Ghost according to his own will. Now, when he came 2,000 years ago, what did he do? When he walked this earth, what did he do? He did miracle after miracle. What did the apostles do? They did miracle after miracle. There was dead that was raised back to life. There was people who was crippled who received their limbs back. There were people who were deaf who were made to hear. There were people who were blind that were made to see. You see, God confirmed through miracles and signs the gospel of the Lord Jesus. 2,000 years ago, he confirmed that it was the message of our salvation. Now today, folks are focusing on the miracle. The miracle is not what we're focusing on. This morning in Sunday school lesson, Eric was teaching in Colossians chapter 3, if you be risen with Christ, set your affections on above and not on the earth. Our focus, our affection should be on our salvation, which is Christ. Folks have let that slip. In the modern church today, it's not much preaching about Christ. It's psychology and feel-good messages and not much about the Lord Jesus. It's about men. It's about works. It's about what we've done. It's about the glorification of men. But that's not our salvation. We've let it slip through the years. We've lost it. We've missed it. It slipped through our hands. We've missed the prize. But is there a punishment for it? Is there going to be a judgment for it? Do we have any other hope that we can actually have outside of that so great a salvation? Now, what are you talking about, Pastor? How can we let it slip? Well, you can let it slip by not acknowledging him. Look with me in verse 5. For unto the angels hath he not put in subjection the world to come, whereof we speak. But one in a certain place testified, saying, what is man that thou art mindful of him? Or the son of man that thou visited him? Thou makest him a little lower than angels. Thou crownest him with glory and honor, and did set him over the works of thy hand. Thou hast put all things in subjection under his feet, for in that he put all in subjection under him, he left nothing that is not put under him. But now we see not yet all things put under him, but we see who? Jesus, who was made a little lower than the angels for the suffering of death, crowned with glory and honor, that he, by the grace of God, should taste death for every man. Now, let me kindly explain to you a little bit what's going on here this morning. We've been in a rich study in the book of Galatians. And it's been so rich, it's just been in my spirit so much all week and the last week. And I just can't get it out. And those of you who don't come to Bible studies on Wednesday night, you're missing out. And the Holy Spirit's been speaking deep into us in the study of the book of Galatians. And actually, we were looking at what Paul was embracing, and he was rolled up his sleeve, and he was fighting that salvation has something to do with works. But it doesn't. Our salvation is of him. We've let that slip through the last few years that we actually thought that men had part in their salvation. Let me tell you what. We did not have one part in it. The Lord Jesus saves us. The Lord Jesus is the captain of our salvation. We've let that slip through the years. And somehow, some way, we think that it's something that we've done, that we're going to be able to inherit eternal life, and it ain't going to happen. And we're going to let it slip. We've got to hold the wrong branch, and it's broke, and it's moving away. And somehow, some way, in the feel-good churches today, we say, well, God's going to accept you just like you are. You're a sinner, and you don't have to trust Jesus Christ. You can live like you want, but just somehow come in, and we'll ordain you through what we do and what we think is works and what we do we think is right. Then you can be saved, and that is far from the truth. We've let the message of the gospel slip. The message of the gospel that Jesus Christ came 2,000 years ago. He was made a little lower than the angels, and he walked this earth. And the message of the gospel is that he walked, and through suffering, he gained our life through death, and that he took our sin on the cross. On Wednesday night services, we studied a few Wednesday nights ago that on the cross is a symbol of a severe judgment. Now, under the law that the angels ordained at Sinai, under the law which 20,000 chariots of angels and thousands of angels ordained the law that Moses received at Sinai. And men were under that law, and they died when they broke that law. And that law was a schoolmaster for us as we realized that we couldn't do it. It kept us in line, but we realized that we broke the law. And under the law, when they did a severe judgment, such as a heinous crime, they carried out the punishment. They would put them on a cross, the Roman judgment on the cross. And they would put them on that cross on a tree, and they'd hang them on a tree because they committed a severe crime that was worthy of death. They just weren't stoned, but they were put on a cursed tree, a cross. Today in religion, we have a symbol of a cross as a religious symbol. But in actuality, the sign of a cross is a curse. A cross is a curse. A cross is a curse where a severe judgment is to be paid. The message that's missed today is that men don't preach the cross anymore. Amen. They don't preach that our sin debt was so heinous and so severe that Jesus Christ had to come on this earth and pay a penalty that you and I couldn't pay. And he was hung on that cruel tree, that cruel cross. And it should have been us that were hung there because our sin was filthy and there was no detergent, nothing that men could do to appease or to pay the debt that we owed a righteous, holy God. And the sins that were so heinous and so grievous that all of us are guilty of, Jesus took that penalty and he took that curse and he was made a curse for us that we actually might have eternal life. The blood of Christ cleansed our sin. The blood of Christ that men will not preach anymore. The blood that dripped down at Calvary, that's archaic, is not being preached in our pulpits today. We've let that slip. And we've lost the message. The modern church doesn't preach it today. They do not preach the cross. They do not preach the blood that cleanses our sin. Therefore, it slipped. And guess what? Folks are going to pay severe. There's a severe penalty to pay because of truth that's been lost. Now, Brother Danny, where are we headed toward? The earth is groaning, as I preached to you a few weeks ago. The earth is in judgment. The earth is wearing out. It's like a garment. It's about to be folded up. And she's wearing out. She's wanting to be redeemed. She's wanting to be delivered from the curse. The Lord Jesus is going to deliver the earth from the curse. However, there's judgment to come on the earth. We are actually in like labor pains. The floods, the earthquakes, the groaning of the earth. She's waxing old. She's wearing out. And judgment is coming. Judgment is coming on the earth. We are like in a foreshadow. When you see a giant coming, you're going to see a shadow. When you see the sun setting and the sun comes behind the trees, you're going to see shadows. We are actually in the shadow of a severe judgment. We're actually in the shadow of God going to judge the earth because of breaking his laws and commands. We're in the shadow of that. Now let me tell you what else. You and I are in the shadow of judgment. Judgment is coming. Now, this is not a popular message, But it's a message that we have to preach. The modern church and modern society and the love and pleasures of this world hates and despise this message. The scripture says we're none good. We're like an open sepulcher. Our mouth is like death. Jesus Christ paid our debt. We've let that slip. We've missed the message. We've not preached and taught the message. And folks have lost it. Turn with me, if you would, Revelation chapter 1. Judgment is given to the Lord Jesus, John 5:22. All judgment is committed to the hands of the Lord. The earth is under judgment. The political systems will be judged. The armies of the world will be judged. Every man will face the Lord. What will he look like when we see him? What will he be like? What will his appearing be? What at the judgment seat, what will he be like? Now John, who was on the Isle of Patmos, who in some type of spirit, in his spirit, went up into third heaven, he'd already seen what Jesus looked like. He was a beloved disciple of the Lord. He knew what he looked like on the earth. Here he describes him in heaven. John 1. And he's in a different form than what he was on the earth. On the earth, he was like a meek lamb. But in heaven, he's going to be different. Look with me in chapter 1, verse 13. In the midst of the seven candlesticks, which are the churches, walks around one like the Son of Man, clothed with a garment down to his foot, girt about the paps with a golden girdle, standing for purity and clearness, and no sin in his life at all. There's no impurity with the Lord Jesus Christ. He is gold. His head and his hairs are white like wool, pure as snow, and his eyes were as a flame of fire. The Bible says his eyes roam to and fro over all the earth, beholding the good and evil. The Lord looks over all of us. He sees everything. His eyes are searching his judgment, and his feet are like fine brass. Now, brass is typical of judgment. When you see brass in the Bible, it's judgment. His feet is judgment. As if they burn in a furnace, and his voice is the sound of many waters. And he had in his right hand seven stars, and out of his mouth went a sharp two-edged sword, and his countenance was as the sun that shineth in his strength. And I want you to look with me in Revelation chapter 20, if you would, and flip over to verse 12 in Revelation chapter 20. And this message of the cross, this message of judgment to come, this message that salvation is only in Christ Jesus, that he took our sin debt and that our sin judgment was poured out upon Christ at the cross, has been lost and not preached over the last few years with fervency and urgency, and that folks have missed the message and they're not focusing on Christ Jesus as they should, and they're missing out and they're not spreading the gospel with that fervency. And I want to tell you something this morning. If the Holy Ghost is in you, if you've been born again and your focus is on the Lord Jesus Christ, it don't matter who you're around, you want to tell them about Him. Amen. Folks have let that slip because the pressures of this world and pressures of social life, and you're afraid that folks are going to look down upon you because you preach Christ. Preach Christ! Amen. Satan tries to put our spirit out and damper it out because the world looks at us and looks upon us as impotent and weaklings and folks who just somehow mentally deranged, and folks who are getting old, or folks who are too mentally small to think about great things. But I want to tell you what, this morning, the Lord Jesus Christ is the great thing to talk about this morning. Amen. He's our life, and I don't want to lose it, praise God. It's all about Him. Amen. I'm not interested in what the world thinks about me. I'm not interested in having the socialite people of the world think great of me. Let them think what they want. I don't want to lose Him. Amen. I don't want to lose Christ. He is the captain of our salvation. It's Him this morning. So as you look at look at Revelation chapter 20 of judgment that's coming on the land and on the earth and in the future as we take our sitting to the great white throne judgment. And if you're there, you've missed Him. Here's what's coming. The angels ordained it. 20,000 chariots of angels, thousands of angels on Mount Sinai, they ordained the law. If you break one little law, you're guilty of them all. None of you in here has kept all the law. None of you. No matter how good you were, none of you has been able to keep all the law. All of you are sinners. We're all sinners saved by the grace of God. We've all come short of the glory of God. Judgment will be on every man and woman. There's a summons that's going to go out to all the earth and the seas. Every man will be summoned to the great white throne judgment. Well, Brother Danny, you're supposed to be preaching about love this morning. Let me tell you what, Jesus did love us. He sent His Son to die for us. Brother Danny, you're supposed to make us feel good, not feel bad. Listen, I don't want you to let this salvation slip. Why has this so great a salvation slipped? Because we've not spoke it. We've not spoke it with clarity. And we've not preached the gospel with fervency. And we've become engrafted into a world that hates Christ. The world don't want you to speak of Christ. They don't want you to speak of His glory, who He was, who He is. They don't want Christ spoken nowhere today. So don't let Him slip. Hold fast. Don't lose this. What shall happen to us if we miss this so great a salvation? Would you like to know this morning? Would you like to know the consequences of missing so great a salvation? Would you personally like to know for yourself what's going to happen to you if you miss Christ? Would you like to know? Would you like to know what the future holds? You know, I'm not a palm reader, but I know the Bible speaks the truth. And I don't believe in that mess no way. But I want to tell you what, we can read what's going to happen in the future. There's going to be a summons goes out all over the land. Every man's going to be summoned that misses that salvation. Listen what happens. Revelation chapter 20. I want you to look. Very clear. Verse 12. Revelation chapter 20. And I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God. And the books were opened. Another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged out of those things which are written in the books according to the works. And the sea gave up the dead which were in it. And death and hell delivered up the dead which were in them. And they were judged, every man according to their what? Works. Who's going to judge them? Christ. The Lord Jesus. He will judge every man according to their works. Every man. If the angels, 20,000 angels and thousands of angels ordained the law at Sinai. If the angels ordained it. And they said that every act and transgression was punished. How shall we escape if we neglect so great a salvation? The world has neglected it today. The world has neglected the message of the cross that Jesus Christ is the King of kings and Lord of lords. And they'll stand before Him who is worthy to judge the whole world. He's worthy. He's Christ. He walked this earth and humbled Himself and lowered Himself smaller than angels. He suffered for men and women. He died for us that we might have hope of eternal life, that He might bring us into sonship. But we've missed the message. We've let it slip. We've lost the truth of the gospel. In many areas of the world today, we don't preach Christ, and we've let it slip. We've lost it. Amen. It's Him. It's Christ. Amen. The pulpits have grown silent in America. I was so impressed and amazed last night as I listened to Governor Huckabee. And he was riding high in the polls, 17-18% with Mitt Romney for the Republican presidential nomination. And he was making an announcement last night on the Fox TV show. And he said his heart told him that he should not run for president. Now, there's no greater honor in the United States than to be the president. He was right there on the verge riding high in the polls to get the Republican nomination and probably would get the presidential office. But on public TV, he made this statement. My heart tells me I should not run for president. And then he made an astounding statement. I'm a believer in Jesus Christ. And I have faith in the Lord. My heart inside me exploded. Folks, Christ Jesus is a living Lord. He was dead, and now he's alive. And he lives in heaven. He's our Lord. This governor knows Christ. He listened to him. He listened to that voice. Now, that be the president of the United States, one of the highest positions, men's way, for men's honor. But he listened to a higher calling. Can I tell y'all something this morning? To be right here today, preaching the gospel, is the highest calling. Amen. To be a child of God is the highest calling that you can have. Y'all are God's chosen people. To be a child of the King is the highest glory that you can have. Amen. He's bought us into sonship. He's bringing us into glory. A marvelous place to be this morning in the house of the Lord. But there's judgment coming on those who neglect so great a salvation. They're going to be summoned from all over the world, all over the earth. The scripture says in verse 13 that the sea will give up the dead of chapter 20 of Revelation. Death and hell will be delivered up, and they're going to be judged. And this is the second death. This is the lake of fire. Brother Danny, there are some people that don't know. The out-and-out sinner is going to be there. Did y'all know that? A man that was just old sinner, didn't have no time for God. He was a rebel raiser, and he just run, didn't do anything. He just hated God and hated church, and he's going to be there. You know what he's going to be? He's going to be judged. He's going to spend eternity without God. There are people right up and down this road every day, past this church and past these churches here. There are people passing up down here on Sunday morning. They chasing the lakes and the fishing and the hunting and everything else out there that the world has to offer. I love to hunt fish, don't get me wrong, but I know there's God in heaven. Amen. They're chasing their money, they're chasing the green dollars, and on Sunday they're out there having a good time. Can I tell you what? They're going to be standing there that day. The out-and-out sinner, they're going to be judged, and you know what's going to happen? They're going to spend eternity without God. There are some more folks going to be there. They're going to be self-righteous. They go to church every Sunday, and they sound better than them because, I don't steal, I don't lie, and I don't commit adultery, and I've got a good job. And, you know, they're going to be standing there because they had no time for Jesus. They're going to be there too. You know what? They're going to be condemned to eternity without God. There's another group going to be there. And here, I believe it's going to be more there because of this reason than anything else in the world. You know what it is? Procrastination. I don't have time for God today, maybe tomorrow. There are going to be a lot of young people that the Holy Spirit dealt with. I don't have time for God. I got to go and make my way in the world. You know what's going to happen? They're going to put it off, and after a while they're going to get too busy out there, and they're not going to have time for God. They're going to chase the dreams of this world, and they're going to miss God because they procrastinated. There's young people that the Holy Spirit knocks on their door, and they say, I've got to have the world. I don't have time for God. You know what's going to happen? They're going to stand there before the Lord Jesus that day, and they're going to be judged, and they're going to be condemned for all eternity because they're going to be punished for their transgressions. But here's another class that will be there, folks. I believe it's going to be more on account of this reason than anything else. And y'all listen close to me. I'm not saying any of you in here is lost this morning. Don't get me wrong. But you are lost if you've never rejected or never believed in Christ Jesus. Amen. But I want to tell you what, there are going to be a lot of church members there. Amen. Did y'all have y'all ears open then? There are going to be a lot of church members at the great white throne judgment. A church membership's wonderful. Think you should do it. But let me tell you what, church membership, it's not going to save you. Amen. There are going to be a lot of church members standing at that great white throne judgment. And they're going to face that Jesus that died for them. And they're going to see his feet of brass. And they're going to see his feet of his hair white as wool. And they're going to stand there and say, oh, Lord, I've done all these good things. I've been in church. I give money. I went to church. But you know what? They never knew Jesus Christ. Didn't know him. Didn't have faith in him. And you know what he's going to say to them? Depart from me, you work of iniquity. Judgment is coming. Church members, a lot of church members are going to spend eternity in the lake of fire. Well, what about those folks who didn't hear the gospel? Would you like to look in Luke chapter 12 with me? That's why it's important that we take the message of the gospel and support the gospel all around the world to get this message out. There are some folks going to be there who never heard the gospel. They lost, folks. Never heard. You mean they lost too? Yes, sir. There's only one way, and that's faith in Christ. Luke chapter 12, if you would, 47, 48. Let me settle this question with you this morning. Let me give you the urgency of what we're doing here. If you're playing church today, quit playing church. If you're just here because you're going to go through some religious calisthenic and you were raised up to go through religious calisthenics, you need to quit. I'm serious with you. Quit doing it. Get your faith in the Lord Jesus. Your life will be empty and out of sorts, and you're going to be miserable. Quit playing religion and accept Christ. Why? Because the scripture says so. Look at it. Luke 12, 47, 48. And that servant, look closely with me. And that servant, which knew his Lord's will and prepared not himself. Oh, my goodness. Brother Danny, what are you saying? I'm saying you sit in here in this church Sunday after Sunday and you hear Christ preach, and you have not personally said yes to the Lord Jesus and asked the Lord Jesus to save me. I'm a sinner. What's going to happen to you? Let me read it to you. And prepared not himself, neither did according to his will, shall be beaten with many stripes. You're going to be suffering for all eternity, friend, because you're going to be at that judgment seat. What about them didn't know? Well, listen to what it says, verse 48. And he that knew not and did commit things worthy, they broke the law. That law that was ordained at Sinai. What's going to happen to them? And did commit things worthy of stripes, shall be beaten with few stripes. For unto whomsoever much is given of him shall be much required, and to whom men have committed much of him they will ask some more. Let me tell you what, folks, there's fire on the earth. There's things coming. There's sureness of judgment to come. Can I say to you this morning, the verdict has been passed. Judgment has been handed down. What are you going to do this morning? Or what are you trusting in? Are you procrastinating? Are you trusting in your church membership? Are you trusting in your good works? Have you made yourself ready? Have you said yes to Jesus Christ? Have you personally said, you know what, Lord, I'm a sinner. Save me. I knew to do that, but I didn't prepare myself. You know what? You'll stand before him, and you'll suffer judgment. As we stand this morning, don't let it slip. If every act of sin was judged, every transgression was judged, every act of disobedience was judged, the angels ordained it, 20,000 chariots of God and thousands of angels. The writer of Hebrews says, be careful and not let the things that you've heard slip. For how should we neglect so great a salvation? What's going to happen if we neglect it this morning? You're going to miss Jesus, and you're going to face judgment, and you're going to spend eternity in a place you don't want to spend, where there'll be no chance or opportunity to ever come out. What are you saying, preacher? I'm saying I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. For it's the power of God unto salvation. It was first given to the Jews and now to the Gentiles. I'm not ashamed of it. Neither should you be. Make yourself ready this morning. Don't let it slip. If you let it slip, there's going to be no remedy. There's going to be no remedy. There's going to be no hope. There's going to be no help. You're going to be lost for all eternity. I plead with you this morning. Don't be ashamed of it. Let me tell you what. The Holy Ghost will be shut up in your bones. And when you stand before people and men and women, you're professing with your mouth. I know where I'm going. I know to whom I believed. I know what my hope is. It's in Christ. As we sing this morning.